Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today we are gonna see how to create Docker files and Docker Compose files in a practical example, in a how to do it end to end. And I'm gonna use a real example, something I have already running in production. Okay, let's start. First of all, some logistics to you be able to replicate this on your local environment. You will need to have Docker desktop installed. I'm using a Windows 11. Also, I use Windows System Linux as a backend of my Docker desktop. To configure your Docker desktop with that, you just need to install the Windows System Linux and integrate it here with your Docker desktop. Have two variants of the Windows System Linux, Debian and Ubuntu. Both of them can be used as backend of the Windows System Linux. Also, if you plan to use GPUs, I also recommend you to have installed the let me find out where is 1 second. Yeah, here we are. The NVIDIA Container Toolkit. If you plan to again have installed use GPUs with your containers. So you had on the channel already videos how to set up Windows System Linux with CUDA support, and also how to create Docker, the basics of Docker files. You don't have how to install this. I will create soon a video how to install and test the NVIDIA Container Toolkit. If you don't need to use GPUs in your deployment, don't use it. But well, it's a good idea to have it because you never know. And then this way you may use it on the future. Okay, so let's start as well. Let's remove this. So how I organize my stuff? I'm going to show you how I deploy a custom classifier. I have five components in this application. Part of there is a MFlow, and the other one is a container which contains a model, essentially a T5, a transformer T5 base, which I fine-tune with for document classification with some documents that the final user provide, also the labels. We are now going to review how to do the Docker container, the custom classifier. We are going to see just how to build the Docker for that custom classifier. This custom classifier need GPU support, and I will show you how to reserve GPU resources at running time. You need to distinguish in between building Dockers or building the components of your deployment and the non-run it, because the use of the Docker files are different. So for building a Docker, you use a Docker file. For running a different or just one container, you use a Docker file. So one is a Docker file is for building the container itself, and the Docker Compose is to run it. I want to make that explanation. So I will show you how to build the different components one by one, how to later on create the Compose, where you define the different services in your Docker infrastructure. You can use this later as well to deploy as a base to deploy this to Kubernetes or K K8, it's exactly the same how I have it in production. So we had our QA or pre-production environment in a virtual set, in a VM, in this case is in Azure. I had other examples in Google Cloud, but in this case we are going to see something in Azure. So the QA system work in a or pre-production work in a VM, which we had, where we had a VM with a T4 GPU, and also there we have a Docker desktop with the NVIDIA container toolkit installed, and then on before to move the Dockers and the all the Dockers and the all the components of the application to Kubernetes, we tested there, we made the final test, the final checks, and also the is the endpoint of the CI/CD pipeline. In this case, we had a second a step that we execute manually at the end to deploy to Kubernetes, and then our CI/CD pipeline finish after building the different components, the different of the application in a deployment into this virtual server, into this VM, where again we have a Docker desktop running, and we can test it there before deploy manually to Kubernetes. So to start with, all the application I have it in a repository. In this repository, I had the software of the different components, and also the different configuration files, either for building the containers or building the Docker infrastructure, or even building the building pipeline in this case in Azure DevOps. We are now going to look today to the building pipeline. We will look only to the how to create the Docker files and the Docker compose, and make an example and run all these examples after the explanation, and see how to, but you can later on copy or reuse what you are gonna see here into your local environment. I will pass at least the Docker compose or Docker and Docker files to later, or just reuse it for your local environment. Obviously, I cannot pass you the application, because this is something that is for the place I'm or for my job in few words. So I'm using here git command line. I'm in my repository, and here I just simply work with VS Code. In my case, I run VS Code and I enter into my application. If you have similar environment, I recommend you two interesting plugins. One is Docker plugin, where you can build or connect or to manage the different components of your Docker infrastructure, and the second one, Remote Explorer. This is to connect two different detective AI. Yeah, probably can use this. This is to connect to VMs and to do remote software into remote machines, in few words. This you can use it to connect to your via tunnels, for example, to a Google Colab, to a VM like in this case, or to a VS, the Windows System Linux targets. So I use to have this to do the final text on the QA, in my QA in the pre-production. So I connect via SSH with a tunnel with my VS Code, and then on I can run locally there or test some components before again and do the latest test before we deploy to production. So this It's very useful working in local, building your dockers, connecting to your dockers, etc. etc. It's really interesting plugin in VS Code. I recommend you. Again, you can do what you want, but it's gonna be very useful and will help you a lot. If you don't want to use everything using the command line. And the second one, again, the Remote Explorer, is how I used to work. Well, let's move. I had five components on my application. One is the there is five components. These components are the Emerflow infrastructure, which is essentially three containers: the Emerflow tracking server itself, the database, which is here MariaDB, MySQL, and PHP MyAdmin, which is a front to manage the database. Then on I have a container with the ML application, which is running in an individual container with essentially is an endpoint with fast API, and this endpoint exposes different entry points to either fine-tune a model, an LLM, and then do inference with that LLM. Everything I do during the fine-tuning and also during inference is locked into the Emerflow infrastructure. And then when you lock a new model, this model returns a URI, and register this model in the model registry in Emerflow. And then to do inference, you can point to that entry or to that model into the model registry, use it. So you have this way, you can have multiple models for multiple sets of documents with multiple classifications, and the only thing that you need to do is just point to the right model into the model registry, send a request to the inference endpoint with the model that you want to use, and then you will receive back a tag with the classification of that model according to the configuration that was used to fine-tune that model. And finally, we had an NGINX container, which is a reverse proxy, which essentially this we use it to expose and to in internet what we want, and also to rewrite the TCP ports where the applications are writing into names or folders in our web application. Okay, sorry. We are going to start for the different components. I used to use two different files, one for the local. I test everything in local, and then once it's in local, I have a different Docker compose for the deployment in the QA, in the pre-production. So the difference essentially is which images we use. So there is two types of images. One is those that you download directly from GitHub Hub, sorry, Docker Hub, and the other ones are the ones that you download either from your local Docker infrastructure or from, like in my case, you can take a look here from the image registry in Azure in this way. This is just the URI on my registry container in Azure. It can be whatever, it had to be only a container registry. So that is the only difference. And in the case of the production, I use it as well, the GPU, reserving a GPU for my custom classifier. The rest is the same, I'm gonna cover this right now. So you have a section in your Docker compose which contain the services. This every service is a container which had a purpose. In this case, here you see this is the container MySQL, which contain a database. This is the database where we are gonna keep all our metadata of all the experiments that we run in MLflow. So you have an image. The image is the base that we are gonna use for that container. A distinction, again, I don't remember if I mentioned, Docker Compose is to run the containers. So you provide here the configuration to run the containers, and Docker Files is to build the containers. Here, this service is gonna use directly an image from Docker Hub. In the case that we don't use it, this is supported. You have to create the Docker with your Docker file before running the Docker Compose. So this means when I'm pointing here to this image, this means that before, this is a custom Docker, you have to build it. Okay? So let's first of all see all the components and what means all these tags in or all these attributes in the Docker Compose, and then we will look at the custom classifier and MLflow containers which had custom Dockers. So here we have the image. This is the name of the image. This is the container name and host name. This is just tags to either do internal ping in the network, in the network that you set up as well here in the Docker Compose, and to make connections in between the different containers. I put all my secrets in that environment file, which essentially contains all the secrets and variables that we need to use. For example, here, this variable is defined in the environment file. Obviously, this is not how to say posted to the repository. This is excluded in our Gitignore. For the deployment, in local, we have it in local, and also we have it on the Azure DevOps in the environmental variables that you can define there. Exactly the same that you have it in an .env file, you can set up the same on Azure DevOps. And then these variables are just defining what we need to, in this case, are the ports where are running physically the database. In our case, we are not using the conventional ones. And then we run it in a different port and expose it in the ones that is expected to be running the MLflow. This is the environmental variables for the MLflow Docker. So the MySQL root password, the MySQL password, database, and user. Everything is taken from here, and then on you can access inside the Docker to these environmental variables using echo dollar variable. This is the secrets files. The same that I'm using here. So when you set up this, is later on copy directly to this for in this case password one is copied to this run secrets folder in the Docker. When you run the Docker Compose, what you specify here in secrets is copy to this folder. If you specify secrets password one and password two, this is two files. TXT, you will see it later on. Well, you can see it now. This is the definition of secrets, password one and password two. They are two files which are in my folder secrets, which contains the root password of the MySQL and the MLflow user password, which is the password of the user that we use to connect to the database. They are in two files. And then when you are composing the file, what you specified in secrets is copied to the folder run secrets of the Docker. Then on We specify a volume. The volume is a permanent file system that we use to keep all the tables of our database. Obviously, when you shut down the Docker, everything that is running or is saved on the Docker, as the Docker is ephemeral, it will disappear. In order to preserve what you write down on the tables of your database, we use a permanent volume, which you define here as well on your container. On your Docker Compose, this is a permanent volume which can increase the size on demand. And then on here on the database volume, we set up the place where MySQL is keeping physically the tables. And networks, when you create a Docker Compose infrastructure, you can set up different networks. The network is physically as a physical network, as a conventional network, where you are plugging your machines, no? It's a network. Let's imagine that you have a switch, a network switch or a network hub, and then physically you connecting this to like connecting this to a to the same switch, no? And then you provide doing that Docker is going to provide an IP address of this container in that network. So every definition of network here, we just had one, it will create a C-class IP address, C-class network, and it will assign an IP of that network to the container if you just specify that it belongs to that network. You can have as much network as you want. You can define as well kind of firewalling, defining the which ports are available to be used on that network. The easiest is just to put everything on the same network, but again, you can do kind of segmentation and put different containers in different networks and allow communication in between networks as well. This is the networking side of the Dockers that we are going to cover here, the basics, just to you understand how to the Dockers communicate in between them. If you don't specify the network, the Dockers will not be able to communicate in between each other. So this is quite important because at the end in this application there is different components which speak each other. So for example, the custom classifier is logging everything in the MRFlow infrastructure, so it needs to speak with the MRFlow tracking server and artifact repository. At the same time, MRFlow speaks or communicate with the database to keep or to save all the metadata that MRFlow is generating, and then it save it on the tables in MRFlow, etc., etc. So it's important to understand this concept because the connections in between the different components of your Docker infrastructure have to be predefined, and if you don't do it, it will not be possible to connect or to communicate in between the different components. So we have a second component, which is the PSP MyAdmin. This is just a front to manage the database. And again, here the only thing that is new is that we have here a depends on. This is meaning that we depends on this building, this container be created correctly. It is not created correctly, then the one that is depending on it is not going to be to be created. So if this component doesn't start correctly, you will not be able to run PHP MyAdmin. So here again, we are taking an image from Docker Hub. We give a name, depends. We use the environment files here. Environments variables, secrets, port exposed. This is the port, local port in the Docker exposed to this port. This is the port that everybody in the network, in the Docker network, can query or can connect. Then we have MRFlow. MRFlow Sorry, we are in the production ward. Let's take a look to the local. So we get an image with the name Detect AI MLflow lattice. So this is in my Docker infrastructure. So I had to have a Docker. It's not, it will fail when you run the Docker. This is again Docker Compose is to run the images. So you have to build this image before to place it here. In the production one, I'm pointing to the one I have in the Azure container repository, which is created with my pipeline. You look at my pipeline, I'm building in the stage, pushing the different Dockers to the container registry in Azure. But again, this is another story that we are not gonna see here. So again, the Detect AI MLflow is the image that contains that MLflow server name, blah blah blah. This is another interesting stuff. Build arguments. This is the parameter that you pass to the repository, to the Docker at the time that is gonna be built and it's gonna be the case running as well. So let me show you how it. So in my MLflow container, I'm using a user, which is going to be the user that under the one that it will be running the application MLflow. It's not a good idea to run the applications under root because root had the maximum privilege, and the way that I do is just, well, I set up a user on my environment file .env, and then on I pass the users at building time, and then on execution time as well, the same in that case, to first of all use it for running with the command user. And I'm saying here that the Docker is gonna run under the privilege of the user that I pass on the argument, and then on I use as well this to create a user inside the Docker and a home where in the home of that user it will be running the application itself. So later when we cover the Docker file, we will take a look to that. And then on the way to pass the build argument where when you run the Docker Compose is like this. And then on the same dependency environment files exposing port, and here I'm just mounting a local folder inside the Docker. Why I'm doing that with MLflow? Because again, the Dockers are ephemeral, so once you shut down the Docker, everything that is inside lost. So in order to preserve the artifacts that you are logging when you are running an experiment in MLflow, what I'm doing is just pointing the folder where MLflow will place every single artifact that you log in MLflow, or MLflow log automatically. You are running experiments with autolog, will be placed physically in a folder in the host that is running the Docker infrastructure. This folder is just a folder inside your file system, in this case in Windows or System Linux, and this can be as well at the same time a share to a folder in a file server or even a bucket or a bucket in Amazon, in Azure, or in Google Cloud. This way, once the Docker has to be shut down for maintenance or for to solve any problem or to just deploy another version, what you have in your artifact repository, you will not lose it. It will be keep on the on because it's a finally archive or serialize into a physical folder which is not depending of the container itself. This is a persistent folder in the host that is running the Docker infrastructure. We attach, as you see here, all the components to the same network. This will allow us to communicate in between the different components. Here the custom classifier, I use as well a Docker file, an image that I had to have created. And similarly here, hostname, I expose a port, depends on MySQL restart every time that you dump or up your Docker infrastructure and connect it to the same network. And finally, I had NGINX, which is a reverse proxy, and then on this will rewrite the and expose some of the services that you have defined here into folders under your root URL. Just imagine that you had https://www.thatexample.com and what NGINX create is different folders, for example, custom classifier. When you point to that, it's going to redirect this according to the configuration that we set. I will show you now. It will redirect this request to the container in the port that you specified in the configuration file. So let's say here, for example, in my config, in the local conf, you can take here in the folder custom classifier, when you point to the URL, in this case localhost / custom classifier, you will be pointing directly to http://custom classifier / 5020, which is essentially the entry point of my application in the custom classifier Docker. So, and this is exactly the same for the rest of the components that you want to expose in front of the reverse proxy. We expose in local PHP admin, custom classifier, so here, and Emberflow. In this case, everything is running under localhost in the port 80. So if you point your browser to http://localhost and you put the folder custom classifier, you will get the entry point, the root of the custom classifier. You put Emberflow, you will see the Emberflow UI, and you point to PHP MyAdmin, you will see the front of the database administration tool. So now let's move to the Docker Compose, to the Docker files. For Emberflow, I use a base of Python 3.11. I take the argument that I send by command line or in the Docker Compose. And then I just take here in the Emberflow argument and I assign this to the environmental variable user Emberflow. There is a difference in between an argument and environment. Arguments, you can use it during building the Docker, and environment, you can use it either in building, and also it's going to be part of the environmental variables of your Docker at running time. So once you are running the Docker, you will see that you have an environmental variable with the name user_Emberflow, and you can query or use it for any purposes. Here I run the update and install some of the libraries. I used to install some libraries to do later troubleshooting, like NetTools, Nano to edit, props to check which processes are running inside the Docker, and pin to check if there is connection in between different Dockers. Here I removed what is not needed. I hear installing two times props. I just realized that this is absolutely unnecessary. I will remove it from here and later on. And then on here in Emberflow, as I said, I'm creating a group and a user with a home where I will copy all the software necessary for Emberflow, and where I will put the the folder where I'm going to keep all the artifacts that MLflow are producing. And then, as you remember, I'm pointing this home, I'm mapping the home to a physical location into the host, in this case my local file system, and in production or in pre-production into a permanent folder in the server, which at the same time is shared into a file server. Local where I am, so here. Then on I put the path of the home on the path. I set up the working directory of my application to home user, the user I send via parameter MLflow. I copy the requirements, I install the requirements, I create the mechanism, I create the folder for where I'm going to host all the artifacts. I make proprietary and I give permissions to the user to all these folders. MLflow runs where it's going to deposit MLflow all the artifacts. I say that this application is going to run under user MLflow, and I expose the port 5000, which is the port that use MLflow server. And then I just run MLflow server using the environmental variables which we had defined in our environmental file. Backend story, the file artifact root, the file artifact destination, and the parameter no serve artifact, the host. If you write 0.0.0.0, it will use all the available IP address or network cards that you have in your Docker, and the port where it's going to be running the server 5000, which had to match with what you expose here. In the classifier, you had something similar. It's pretty much simple. You just import the, well, listen, before we continue with that, to create the Docker, I put you here, I will patch you later on how to build the Docker. You have to be in MLflow here, the MLflow, and then on you just run Docker build hyper pull, which is pull this image that you are specifying here, hyper-arend. This is removing everything with the same name from memory. You pass the building argument, MLflow using equal holonog, that is the user I'm using in Windows or System Linux, the file that you are going to use to build this Docker, the tag of this, which is the tech.ai hyper-MLflow with the semicolon latest, the latest technology, and use whatever you had from that. So the software that you are going to copy inside the container is everything that you have in this location and down. So in MLflow, and if there is any subfolder there, you copy everything. So the scope for copy is this folder and down, and depending what you specify here in the copy, here we copy everything, we copy requirements, and we store. We don't need to copy anything more, but for example, in this one, we copy requirements and then we copy everything. So everything means config, data set, blah, blah, blah. Everything is going to be copied inside the Docker. We create the Docker. It will not take too long, but while it's creating the Docker, we go to review the custom classifier. Here we use as well 3.11. We update the Docker and install the utils to let the later to troubleshooting. We copy the requirements TXT inside the Docker. We set that custom classifier inside the Docker as a working directory. We install the requirements, we copy the software. Software means everything that we had under custom classifier, and we expose the the port 5020, which is the port where we are going to run Fast API. We will take this file and we will run the application endpoint inside this file, where in the host in 0.0.0.0, this is every IP address available on the Docker, and here we expose the port 5020. So now, well, I don't know why, probably I touched something, but well, it's creating. It's gonna take a while after we create. Here is, we are building Docker, later we will build that one. I will continue when this is finished. Let me just set a stop for a while. Okay, this is done. Now you can check in your plugin, if you have it, the MLflow is just built some seconds ago. And this one, we did it by command line because we had to pass a argument, in a building argument. This other one, the custom classifier, Docker, we don't need to pass anything. So here, well, in the next version, I will set up as well a user, because this is a good practice not to run. You can build as well using the Docker. You just right click on your Docker file, and you can build either in your local Docker or in the on Azure if you had the login. Here you can as well define different logins for different registries. Here I just had set up the my local. In the other computer I have all the configurations. Here you just set up the same label, and well, you can see here as well what is executing. This I suppose is gonna be faster because yeah, everything is taken from the cache. When it's done, we will return and continue with the video. Well, it's just copying. Yeah, well, it's gonna be very fast or not. Okay, I stop. Bien, esto ya ha acabado también. Y bueno, ¿qué vamos a hacer ahora? Ya tenemos nuestros containers, nuestras imágenes creadas. Oh, sorry. Sorry, este. Well, now the Docker was I finished. Now what we are gonna do is we check in our Docker desktop the images. So we have here unused 2 minutes ago, 41 minutes ago. This is the latest one that we have created. We can delete this. There is no need to happen. And then, well, no problem with that. And what now we are going to create to run the Docker Compose. The Docker Compose here is running right now. We just can stop it, and later, and we are going to deploy the next. How to create now or to run the Docker Compose? We go to Docker, which is the folder where I have the my Docker files. You can do it from just, you need to react just the paths. And then on now you execute Docker Compose -f Docker. You point to the file, in my case is Docker Compose local, and then on you just say down. If you say down, you shut down all the containers, and if you say up and hyper d, you detach the execution of this of running these containers. If you don't say, you will be you will be seeing all the logs of your deployment. Let's start the Dockers again. So now we are creating the containers. It should need to be recreated. The configuration is just recreating, as you see here, the tracker and the classifier. And then once they are created, just starting. You can check here now. It's starting the different components, and now all of them are running. And once they are running, you can see in the different containers what's going on. Let's go to the database. So it's starting as load complete, and now you can check in the MLflow tracker. It's running as well. The custom classifier is running as well, and yeah, NGX is running, and our PHP admin is running. Yeah, it's well running. Now you can go as well any of these components. You can go to take a cell, and you can ping one of the other components just to check it. You had visibility, and now you can essentially point to the different components. So you have two options in local, at least when you deploy this to using the production one. You don't have that access. Let's if you point to the 5000 in localhost, you get MLflow obviously, and you can do the same using the tag or the folder that we configure in NGINX. So you remember the configuration in our, sorry, this is the other thing I have to show you later. You go to the configuration, you have MLflow is pointing, rewriting to the MLflow 5000. So when you point to the localhost / MLflow, you are NGINX will redirect the request to MLflow that 5000. Remember, MLflow is the name of the service in your Docker Compose. So let's take a look here. You point there, you have it. So the MySQL is here, PHP admin, again it's, you can point to the 8080 or pointing to PHP admin, the same that we have configured in your, let me check, exactly. So here you have the database with all the tables that MLflow use. Now you want to shut down you just say down, and you will see how the different components start to shut down and disappear from here. Okay, so now we started again, and then again, because probably before it was not very clear how this works. And here we are. So, couple of things I want to tell you as well. Production, in my case, the custom classifier component use a GPU. So, how we set up this, you need to create a section like you see on the screen, where at deploy you just reserve a GPU for that specific component. This way the component will have access to the GPU. Obviously you have to have the GPU installed in your computer. We'll see this now. So you will have to practically write exactly what you see here, unless that you have more than one GPU. The driver had to be NVIDIA. There is no other. Unfortunately, only Docker only works with NVIDIA, and capabilities is the GPU. Here you can do reserves of other components, but here, well, obviously I'm focusing on the GPU. And then on this Exactly what you see here is your component needs a GPU, you will have to do something like this again. The only difference maybe is the number of computers. What more? Do you also work with the with GPUs, you have to have the NVIDIA container CLI runtime installed in your Docker infrastructure. Let me show you one second the page. Here we are. So you need to install the NVIDIA container toolkit. You have here, I will pass you later on this link to you take a look. You had the installation from different architectures, and once you have it, you can test it. NVIDIA list, for example, it will give you all the components that you have installed in your computer, and it was let me remember info exactly. With the info, you can get. So this has to be working in the host that you are running your Docker infrastructure. If you need to have access to your NVIDIA or to your GPU from inside your Docker. If you don't have this, it's not gonna work. So if you depends on having a GPU, other stories, the memory of the GPU, but first of all, you have to have the container toolkit installed, and after that, reserve a GPU container in your machine. So here also another, if you just execute Docker PS, you can see the images that you have running that way right now. And if you set up Docker images, you had another view of all the images that you had in your repository. This is no more than a view that this is what you have running, and the other, the Docker images, is what you have here. And basically that's all. I have here another example of another application. Here is probably simple, it's just a bot, it's just a single Docker. I'm deploying this for another project. This is a deployment in Google Cloud. I have my Docker file, which essentially is practically the same. Well, we are running an application. This case is a is an application with a front in a with a Streamlit. You guys, I'm not using here FastAPI. It's a bot which interacts with Gemini, Gemini embeddings and Gemini models using through Vertex AI. And well, I Dockerize as well the application and running with my Docker Compose. Probably I will use a service probably soon with a database, a MySQL database, to say, for example, you see here now I had some volumes to keep as well the information that had to be permanent, for example, ChromaDB, some documents that I use for a knowledge base, and some files that I'm using to keep the history of the what I'm interacting with the model in terms of prompts, personalized documents, all documents I'm using as an examples in the fuse of the prompts that I'm using with Gemini, and also what the history of the what the LLM is answering me. But probably some of this stuff I will be moving it to a database in a next step in this this project. As you can see here, the Compose is pretty much simple because I only had one container, and also you can take a look here. I just connected to the server, and here you can just run scale. Here I think I need to scale sudo docker ps. And you can see here I have my bot running as well in the port 8051. Okay, that's all. I hope that you find it interesting and useful, because it's really this kind of things you probably you don't need to face it every day, but you need to have a clear idea how to link all the components of your application. This is not that funny than working with LLMs, fine-tuning and many other things, but at the end, the applications doesn't end when you finish the modeling or even writing. There is many steps that you need to do after you have your application in production. And to fulfill the life cycle of machine learning, this is one of the essential parts you need to do. I'm working with Docker. Most of the people is working with Docker, dockerizing all the applications and working in the cloud with the Kubernetes or with the similar configuration that is even more complex. And you need to manage, or if you are like me, that are a one-man shop with I'm working on the modeling side and working as well on the engineering side. And then on this kind of things, if you are working especially on the engineering side as a machine learning engineer or a cloud engineer, the people who is deploying the applications into the cloud, this kind of concept you have to manage them, at least know what are the possibilities, how you can, what you can do, what you cannot, because from laboratory, when you everything is working in a controlled environment in a Jupyter notebook, that to you get this and run an application in production, there is a long way to go. Very long, believe me. And okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope that you find this interesting and useful for your work, your training, or whatever reason that you are watching my videos. And if this is like that, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with your friends and colleagues, just to help me to promote the channel in YouTube. Thank you very much. See you soon.